November 23rd, 2015. Please come to order. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance and a moment of silence. Beth, would you please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Item two is public comment. Is there anyone from the public wishing to comment?
Jeff, come on down.
I'm first on the list, so I'm here for a long due over recognition to the New Milford Town Council, the town of New Milford, and their citizens. The New Milford Town Council from the New Milford Veterans Committee, ladies and gentlemen, let me express our warmest appreciation to all of you for being a regular donor to our organization's causes. Thank you so much for supporting our cause for many years. Through the generosity of donors like you, our organization has been able to obtain several items that meet our needs over the past several years and honor the veterans of New Milford, past, present, and future. Our efforts to honor the veteran is one that is always community-oriented, and we take great honor and pride in being supported by the one entity that makes it happen for all of us, the New Milford Town Council, the town of New Milford, and her citizens. And without your support, none of our efforts would be realized. Your contributions to our efforts remind us always that all the time and effort everyone puts into contributing to the endeavor of the American veteran in New Milford is worthwhile. We do hope you will continue to walk hand in hand with us as we continue this meaningful journey to honor our veterans each and every day of each and every year. Thank you and Godspeed. Respectfully, with honor and pride, Jeffrey McBride, Vice Chairman of the New Milford Veterans Committee. Now, I also would like at this time that the mayor will come and accept this certificate, if it's possible. A certificate of appreciation. This certificate of appreciation is greatly presented to the New Milford Town Council in recognition of sincere appreciation of outstanding service and assistance which contributed to the advancement of the American Legion program's activities dedicated to God and country. Presented by Ezra Woods, Post 31, Department of Connecticut, this 23rd day of November 2015.
Hear, hear. You're working with Century Brass. I have a different thought, and I don't know whether it really works or not, but I certainly think it merits looking into. When you look at the projects that are online for the town of Milford, invariably, if you're going to move the Public Works Department, you're going to be looking at a major project to reconstruct it at Century Brass. I know Century Brass needs to be cleaned up. We're in the process of cleaning it up, but I would suggest that there's a better ultimate use of it. And that is to proceed with cleaning it up, eliminating any of environmental issues, but I have not been, it's not been demonstrated to me that there's any real need to take down the building. I am not aware of any issue with respect to the structural problems of it. I know it needs a new roof. I know it needs to be cleaned up. And I know that the ground needs to be cleaned inside. As I understand it, the outside area of Century Brass property has been pretty well cleaned up. You have an award of $2.25 million to clean up the inside, including taking it down. I would suggest that there's a better solution, and that is to look at the possibility under that grant, if there's any way that it can be modified to clean it up, take off the roof, leave the structure, and refurbish it. And at the same time, putting Century Brass to use for the Department of Public Works. I would suggest that the new Public Works Department is going to cost between $5 to $7 million. I don't know whether that's been addressed, but it would seem to me that that building could be reconstituted after it's cleaned up, using this funding that you have, which, by the way, we're going to have to add to complete it. And instead of taking down the structure, rather, I would do the following. After taking any of the problems off of the roof, obviously it needs a new roof, but I would look at putting solar on the rooftop. It's 8 acres. It's right near the 345 line, such that you could generate a cheaper source of electric. Beyond that, parts of it could be used for additional purposes. And that's what really bothers me. You're looking at cleaning up the current highway department, but you're not doing anything with the real problem along the river, and that is all of the oil companies that are sitting there right next to the river. You're talking about reconstituting and making some sort of a development or a use of the part where Young's Field is. But to me, to do that and leave the oil companies there doesn't make any sense. So I think what needs to be done is there needs to be a utilization of the existing structure at Century Brass for not only the Public Works Department, but for the possibility of relocating some of those businesses and creating some sort of a swap where you utilize that building, perhaps condominiumizing part of it and putting those other businesses on it. Hopefully you'd find a cheaper ultimate resolution to the Public Works Department. You would also clean up a bigger area along the river and therefore really set that up for what it has the potential to be. So I would encourage that as a possibility to look into it. I know you've done a lot of studying, you've done a lot of stuff. Problem is, I'm not aware of the information. The information hasn't been particularly public. So I think it merits looking into and seeing if that can be modified, the grant adjusted, utilized, and the property moved forward accordingly. So that was my thought. I mentioned this to you. The majority of you are on the council for the next session, and I would encourage that possibility, or at least a clarification to me why that doesn't work. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Carl.
Other comment?
Doug?
Good evening, Town Council. My name is Douglas Skelly. I live at 4 Birchwood Lane in New Milford, Connecticut. I've lived here for over 25 years. I'm married to my wife, Trish. I have a son and a daughter, Stephanie and Hunter. I'm here tonight to enlighten you a little bit more about the turf fields. There's been some questions, and I guess in the last week or so, about some of the safety and health issues with it. So hopefully I'm going to clear up some of it tonight for you. First, let me give you some facts about high schools around Connecticut that have turf fields. Within about a 50-mile radius of, you know, I went on the internet and looked it up and spent a good couple hours. There's over 50 turf fields within a 50-mile radius. I stopped there. They could have gone up to 100. Some of them are Brookfield, which has 4, Danbury has 5, Newtown, Richfield, Immaculate, Oxford, Seymour, the list goes on and on. As for the colleges in the state, all state colleges have turf fields in the United States. along with, you have Quinnipiac, you have New Haven, Sacred Heart, that list goes on. There are 125 Division I schools, college football. 79 out of 125 have turf fields. Last year's college championship was played on turf field. Today's colleges are asking kids as they're coming out of high school, what playing surface do you play on? There's a disadvantage and advantage to having turf fields when they're selecting you for scholarships. It's important. It's one of the top three questions when you go to apply for an athletic scholarship, is what kind of field you're playing on. In the NFL, there's 21 out of 32 teams that play on turf fields. 90% of those teams also have playing practice facilities that are on turf alone. Last year's Super Bowl was on turf. There are currently over 10,000 crumb rubber turf fields in the United States, with expected to grow to 18,000 by the year 2022. Sports are different today. When we grew up 25, 30 years ago, there's a lot of club sports now. There's lacrosse, there's field hockey, there's multi-level girls and boys sports, freshman all the way to varsity. Unfortunately, our high school can't handle that kind of traffic. The practice fields, there's just not enough room, there's not enough grass, there's not enough land. Not only at our high school, but our youth sports are suffering. We have youth sports that are on private lands. Some say, well, they have 99-year leases. Well, they really don't. They only have a year-by-year lease. It's reviewed every year. As we know, Garrick Field in baseball, they're losing two fields. At any time, Metastill, they could take the Bulls fields away. So we're running out of room to have these things played. We can also talk about paint. I did some investigating with some of the local leaders of some of the youth sports. Youth football alone spends thousands of dollars on 125 gallons worth of paint a year. Youth soccer, 125 gallons. Youth lacrosse, 125 gallons of paint is used on the private and school grounds. Spoke to the AD at the high school today. 800 gallons a year of paint is used for lining fields. That's a lot of paint that's being soaked up into the ground. Together, it's 1,225 gallons a year that are used between high school and the youth sports a year. Since the high school was opened in the year 2000, 12,000 gallons of paint have been used to line the fields. 12,000 gallons of paint. Together with both sports, youth, it's over 18,000 gallons in 15 years. Over the last few months, I'm a Staples at the high school. I watch a lot of sports. I like the band, the cheerleading. There's a lot of other sports besides football. It's not just for football field. It's a multi-community field. This is what this town needs. We're striving for it. This town has always been second rate to towns around us. This town is too good for that. We need to step up. We need to make these fields real. I've witnessed band members huddling under parking lights, four at a time, under 12 or 15 lights, trying to practice in the dark because they can't use the main field. Several coaches and parents showed their displeasure, away coaches that I'm at the games, saying, how can you allow your kids to play on these fields? They're horrible. The drainage is horrible. The conditions are horrible. I've witnessed a referee blow out her Achilles right in front of me this year because she stepped in a hole. Last year, several sporting events were canceled. We had the home lacrosse team, varsity team. SWC came in and said, we're not going to play here. This field is unplayable. Your home game will have to be moved to Brookfield. Well, on the way there, the bus broke down. Had to get another bus, and there was a home game in Brookfield. Well, they won. Another home game. SWC said, you can't play it here. Got to go to Newtown. Another home game somewhere else. This year, boys soccer. Number one in the state. It's a home game deserved. SWC says, can't play here, you gotta go to Brookfield, turf field. Fields are unacceptable. Currently, the high school field is used 33 times a year. Think about that, 33 times a year. This is a quote from the AD. This is not something they just took out of thin air. I asked him how many times. He says the field can't sustain it. 33 times, that's one out of 11 days. That's 2.75 times a month. We're using this jewel that we have of a school in the back of it we can't use because of poor drainage and because of the use of it. The track, I walked around the track many times. I know a lot of you have been here. The track has over 100 cracks in it. Some are over an inch and a half wide. The lighting is so poor that SWC officials say lacrosse may be not able to play there next year. They may have to play during the day. I pulled up this one study that I found. It was by the Connecticut Department of Public Health. It was in 2010. They did a study over 2 years of fields in Connecticut. There was five different agencies that did this study together. One was the Department of Health itself, Energy and Environmental Protection, University of Connecticut Health Center, and the Connecticut Agricultural Experiment Station. The study was reviewed by Connecticut Academy of Science and Engineering. The overall conclusion of the report, according to DPH, that the use of artificial turf does not represent a significant health risk. Gary Ginsberg, a toxicologist with the Department of Public Health who worked on the state risk, told the Hartford Courant recently there has no concern of even his own children playing on artificial turf. None at all. I'd like to thank the council for the time and giving me the opportunity to shed some light on how important these two fields are. I'm optimistic with the addition of these fields, more families will come into New Milford and help stimulate economic growth. In a famous quote in the movie, Field of Dreams, build it and they will come. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other public comment?
Scott Mullen. He's the last one on the list, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. Peter Mullen, Old Bridge Road. Two things. Number one, I don't know the exact history, but I understand, Mary, you're either the longest or one of the longest serving chief executives of the town. Congratulations.
Thank you.
On the agenda tonight, there's a concern I have with a couple of the appointments, and it's not the people. Actually, the people in question I think are wonderful. It's the date. And there are four people that are being reappointed that their term hasn't ended yet. And the new term doesn't start until January 1st. Three of them, I believe, are the library. So my concern here is, how do you reappoint somebody in the future if their term has not expired? Because if this is the case, it could lead to some very unusual things. I mean, if you can reappoint a month out, why can't you reappoint a year out? Why can't you reappoint 2 years out? This is a major problem. And I don't know if there is anything in the town charter, I couldn't find it, but that doesn't mean it's not there. But I couldn't find anything in the town charter that dealt with this, and I didn't know of anything, state statute, that would deal with anything like this. But I found it odd. Now, when I was on town council, there was a reappointment in June for July, and it was the same town council, it's not an issue. But when it's a different town council, and this term hasn't expired, and you're appointing in the future, my question is, how far in the future can you appoint? So my recommendations on this four people, this two different places this occurs, I think that part should be tabled. I think this would be a bad precedent to set where you can start appointing people in the future. I don't know, have you found a...
Don Hespe for the Northwest Connecticut Public Safety.
Safety Communications.
Yeah. Okay, so I believe, I looked it up online today. None of their terms have expired. They all expired December 31st of 15. And they would all be reappointed January 1st of 15. So their term hasn't expired. Sorry to say, this town council is going to be different in a couple of weeks. So it leads to a very unusual precedent that I think you don't want to set. But, you know, my nephew was a four-year-old. Can I appoint him 30 years from now to be on Parks and Rec? I don't know. I'm throwing that out there. I just think it's a very odd situation. So I hope that you would table that. Again, it's not has anything to do with the people, but it has everything to do with the dates.
Table it, you would withdraw.
Well, couldn't you just...
Well, the table it would dictate that it has to be on the next agenda.
But then that time frame works.
Yes, exactly.
If you tabled it to the next agenda, you know they are still on there, and then the time frame isn't an issue.
And they serve until they're replaced anyway.
Right, but appointing into the future is a very odd thing.
But no conversation, this is comment only.
Thank you.
Other public comment? Yes, sir.
Thank you very much for letting me come here. I represent a manufacturer of telephone equipment.
Your name and your...
Okay, Michael Keegan, and I'm of Sudbury, Massachusetts. And I represent a company called Alcatel-Lucent. And I noticed on one of your agendas that you're going to vote for a new phone system for your school committee.
No,
no.
It's just money.
Yeah, well, what it appeared to me that it was a single source contract, and I just wanted the opportunity for our company to bid on the contract as well, or at least open it up to an open bid.
I'm going to take a liberty here just to let you know, is we don't do any of the purchasing on the town side for the Board of Ed. Mm-hmm. What the Board of Ed has requested is money from their capital reserve account for whatever projects they are working on. And they also have their own very tight, very well-written purchasing authority. Mm-hmm. The town council doesn't tell the Board of Ed how to do their purchasing.
From what I read was that you guys were the final authority on whether or not the money was going to be allocated.
It's the money for their capital projects is the council's purview out of the capital reserve only. And then the Board of Ed makes their own decisions with their facilities subcommittee and their board and then their finance department and purchasing authority.
Well, either way, since however it works, I'd still encourage you to seek for alternate vendors, because just looking at the pricing that was put in the paper, it looked like substantially more expensive than what other vendors, and we're an equivalent vendor, and I wouldn't have come here if I didn't think that this was worth your time, to whatever you need to do to allow us to submit an alternate bid.
And we appreciate you, because I see the finance director in the audience tonight, so for the Board of Ed.
Okay,
I'll talk to them. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Other public
comment? One thing that's set apart from what I did earlier, is the town council going to discuss the future of John Pettibone School tonight?
No.
Okay.
Not that they told me.
Just so that we have it on record, I thought maybe that in the future the town gives strong consideration of things to do with John Pettibone School, that they might consider making it a trade school where people could learn how to be a mechanic or an electrician or an HVAC person or things of that nature, okay? And it would be available to students from their freshman year to their senior year that go through school and graduate. They can't afford to go to college, but they could learn a trade. And when they graduate, they would be able to have completed this school and get a certificate and go out into society and maybe get a job. So I'm asking you for a little, it's a food for thought, maybe something to consider in the future when you discuss the future of John Pettibone School.
Thanks, Jeff.
Okay, thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you, Jeff.
opportunity to both personally and as vice chairman of the council to thank Mayor Patricia Murphy for her 12 years of service to the town of Milford. Whether it be attending Boy Scout functions, firehouse events, VFW honors, town events, and so forth, Mayor, you have made an impression on all of New Milford that love of town and its people cross off political boundaries. When you took office, there was public discourse, both in town hall and in the political arena as well. You were able to quell that feeling and move the town forward. From first budget referendums getting approved to our highest bond rating, you helped guide the town. From farmland preservation to revitalization of the downtown, you helped guide the town. New Milford is a special town. Its community involvement and community spirit make this the greatest town that I know of. You understood that by harnessing talents from all walks of life or party affiliation, knowing that the town would only get better. When being mayor, you also have to make decisions that may not make everybody happy, but the decisions have to be made. Moving New Milford forward has been your motto. Bringing to town over $3 million in grants for projects that would otherwise cost the taxpayer and increase the budget has been a tremendous benefit and allowed for projects that otherwise would not have been accomplished due to budgetary constraints. I personally want to thank you for that. I also want to thank you for making sure that we've had a continuous 9/11 memorial and service every year. For keeping the support the troops sign on the gazebo, as other towns seem to forget about the men and women that are in service to this day. I also want to thank you for the support of the Walk of Honor that we started this year. Watching the pride of the young men and women representing New Milford is what part of our job is. Encouraging pride in our great town and the men and women and children that make this such a great town. Thank you. I also want to thank you for your support of the turf fields that are much needed and will be an asset to our town. Also, your leadership in looking at the long-term needs for the baseball, softball, and sports communities. Providing options and solutions is a key component of the mayor. Thank you for your leadership on this. Thank you for your leadership on farmland preservation and preserving the reservoir dam. Thank you for your leadership in preserving and increasing the waste management. When you took office, I believe there was between $3 and $4 million in the account, and maybe off a little bit. The fund balance growth now has gone to, I believe, how much is it, Ray, today?
$9 million.
$9 million. So, because of the increase in the fund balance, this is going to allow us to do projects that we would never have dreamed or imagined to do. Thank you. We still have work that you've started that we need to complete, from the upgrade to Lendemmie, to the art walk downtown, to the quilt trail, to the river walk, and the list goes on and on. I want to thank you for starting those projects, Mayor. With the help of the incoming administration, we can see these projects to their completion. Walter Lippmann said it best, the final test of a leader is that he leaves behind him and other men the conviction and the will to carry on. New Milford thanks you, Mayor, as I do. And while we're here, what I'd like to do first, Mayor, is if you come over here for just a moment. We have a few things to give you. First being this, that you've made a difference, Mayor Pat Murphy. Thank you for dedicating 12 years to the residents of the town of New Milford. And this is from the residents there.
Here.
This is on a gift for you from the town council. current version. And if you'd like to open it, we'd like to see it. While we're here, see your reaction.
If you get me upset enough, my comments will be short.
That's what I was hoping.
I'm having fun watching you.
Where's your knife?
Oh, in my family, my mother wouldn't let you open a present unless you opened the card.
Chewing gum. I gotta tell you that this is your favorite gum. Mm-hmm. And I was given a pack of that gum. I won't tell you who. They snuck in your office and took it. I took that and I went to 6 different stores to get the gum that you like before the manager told me, well, that's the old packaging. That's why I couldn't find it. It's under a new package. Then I found out that it doesn't come like this. And I went to 3 more stores before I could find it. But I hope you enjoy this. I sure have looked a long time to get it.
Thank you. I really appreciate it. All right. You said, okay, Frank, present. I thought it was going to be a rotary shirt. Oh, that's the next word. Well, thank you. Carry this up.
To make a motion to reappoint all of the following that are
Point of order.
Yes.
Before, that's a general motion. I would ask that the John Pettibone School Facilities Committee be formed. We're getting a new administration, and I don't know what his direction is going to be, but it seems that it's premature to appoint this committee before he has a chance to put his imprint on it. Seeing that this is the last meeting of the old council, the new council will have a new vision, whatever, and there's no rush to do this, and I would appreciate it if they would withdraw the Pettibone Facility Committee until the following meeting.
Well, these are the residents that have called in and volunteered on the phone in reaction to the newspaper article.
Oh, I understand, and the next mayor will have a chance to look at those, and he might just pass those names, but I give him the discretion because he's going to have to work with this committee. So I want to make sure he has his ownership.
Okay.
If that's in the form of a motion to table it, I'll second that, and I think probably would be prudent to do that. We have a new watch commander. And I'm going to concur with Frank that the watch commander probably should be able to, or should take, not to demean the list, because obviously it's volunteerism, but I think it still would be prudent for the incoming commander to review it. Maybe he has some recommendations, and perhaps some people that have approached him. Just simply input, because there is a change in administration. I think we can wait to do this.
Some of the people are here too this evening.
I'm sorry.
I said some of the people are here this evening as well.
Well, we take a vote on it. It's up or down.
So all in favor of tabling?
Madam Mayor, if you table it, this goes to the next meeting or a meeting at a time certain, as opposed to withdrawing it. So this slate would go to a next meeting,
right,
if that's what you want to do.
Randy, do you remember at the first meeting in December is when we do our rules, et cetera?
It's not the first meeting in December. That's an organizational meeting.
Yeah, okay, that was my question.
That's different business.
So it's the next meeting is the 16th or something like that.
It would be the second Monday of December.
Okay.
14th.
Yeah, okay. So that's what you mean by the first meeting, not the organizational meeting.
The organizational meeting is only
totally
for
separate. Okay.
That's a charter mandated.
Because I remember we didn't seem to do business on that organization.
You won't do business on that. It's
yeah.
Just charter.
And that's fine. That the next regular meeting is fine.
I would suggest just withdrawing it for now, and then because if we don't have enough time, or David doesn't have enough time to interview more people or the same people, perhaps it would be better to just withdraw it and to table it.
Well, we could table it at that time.
Or withdraw for
now. Well, we just withdrawn it now, and we can table it if that's the case.
Any other discussion?
Mine was a point of order. So there's no motion. There's no motion on the floor. My concern was a point of order, and he was going to take the whole motion, and I wanted to separate this one item out of it. So I don't know how you would proceed with that. If you want a motion to do that. Well, they're conferring. It's no different than what we just did for
Frank.
No, this is one now. These are my recommendations now. 11/23,
yes.
We already did the committee. That's the difference. The other one was in the future. So it is different.
Yeah. Oh. Right.
I think I got it straight now. A motion would be in order to table the John Pettibone School Facilities Committee, taking it out of...
The appointment.
Yes, amendments, reappointments. And at the next meeting, we can deal with it then. So if there's a motion to table it...
So moved.
I'll second that then.
There's no discussion on motion to table.
No, it's either a vote or not, yes or no, doesn't mean you have to table.
Right.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Opposed.
Okay, who's opposed? I'm sorry.
Opposed to table.
Who's opposed?
Can I just ask for point of clarification?
Yes.
Yes.
Did we make a motion to make all these appointments and then send a motion?
Before he made the motion, I made a point of order.
Yeah.
So there's no motion.
There was no motion, Paul.
There's no motion for the appointments yet. He made a point of order.
And that's the reason I did that, I wanted to clear this up before he makes the motion.
So we're going to table, we're going to table?
Yeah.
Yes, all in favor of tabling?
Aye.
Table?
The John Pettibone.
Tabling the John Pettibone facilities.
Right.
Opposed to table?
So now Pete's motion is 5-4.
You have 5-4.
5-4.
So now Pete, your motion is in order.
What's that?
Your motion is now in order to do what you're going to do. Before I interrupt.
I'd like to make the motion to approve all the appointments that are listed on the agenda. Regular town council meeting, November 23rd, 2015.
Second.
With the exception of the John Pettibone School Facilities Committee.
Yeah, that's what we've been studying.
That's all.
Right, that's all.
Mayor, I just have one question. George Fletcher, the July 1st, 2014, we reappointing.
That's when it had started and it expired and he wanted to be back on it.
So the new date is the second day, not the first day.
We're reappointing him.
Those are the dates that were in the clerk's office.
So you mean he hasn't been reappointed since 2014?
Since serving?
Serving without any reappointment.
Right.
Okay. So we're retro...
You know, he had all those personal things that went on.
Retro, yes, I do. Retroactively, we're affirming his reappointment, which would last him into June.
Yes.
Got it, thank you.
Any other? Pete?
Mayor.
Well, let's... All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Because we have to add to the agenda.
I'd like to suspend the rules and add an item to the agenda.
Second.
Thank you. Notified by the town clerk that for funeral permits, we need to appoint sub-registrar of vital records. I'm putting for Bonnie B. Butcher Smith and Christopher M. Milano, 12/1/15 to 11/30/19.
Second.
Christopher M. Milano.
For the term, can you repeat the term?
12/1/15 to 11/30/19.
When the clerk's office is closed, funeral directors need to have burial permits, and that's what this is for.
May I please?
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Pete?
Mayor, as a courtesy, could we move up the recycling center subcommittee presentation to number 11 to now? Or actually, after your comments.
To 7?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Okay, so one of the other things that I've been working on is for the past couple of months we've been in discussion with the University of Connecticut Extension Program for the possible use of the Sullivan Farm property. The project would be a partnership with the University of Connecticut on behalf of its Department of Extension and the town of New Milford under the auspices of the Youth Agency. Partnership is to implement urban agriculture and youth development programs at Sullivan Farm. The University of Connecticut is looking for a 5-year agreement so that they may implement long-term projects and research such as fruit tree orchards and programs. At this time, a draft proposal has been presented and returned to the University of Connecticut so that it may be included in a formal presentation. And unfortunately, due to the time needed for approval at both ends, it won't be finalized until sometime in December, and I would hope that the new town council will give it their full and up attention. And I also don't usually comment on comment, but I'm going to take a little liberty. And since everyone really doesn't remember, the Century Grass grant is an economic development. So you have to use that money to develop a property for economic development. That is over in our industrial corridor. The use of the moving of DPW isn't a positive thing, and it only would encompass about 9 acres over in the back corner where the hill starts to go up. And that was identified on the grant application that went to the state, along with 5 or 6 other locations of smaller businesses, those that may need rail or not, along with a road through the hill to partner with O&G, and maybe it wouldn't cost us money to build a road, somebody would pay us for material, and also a renewable energy source on the property. And that's what went in, and that's what was approved by the state and got the grant. And to Carl's point, and he always has a lot of good ideas, so I want the next administration to remember that. Carl began giving you all his good ideas. The slab of that building has been contaminated. So that's really also why it has to come down, is the slab is completely contaminated. So the monies that they're using is to take that building down and make the whole site now, 70 acres, usable for industrial development. And that's why we got the money. And the reason we're doing the DPW phase 2 study is because you'll need that if you ever do want to do anything, a public-private partnership with anyone who may want to do TIF financing or a variety of other quasi-government financing programs that they have nowadays, to try and attract somebody that would have some kind of further development for the riverfront. And also, it does include identifying, trying to lure those oil companies out of the river. We did almost have one moved, and then he found something else better. So that's just for you, Carl. Appreciate all your help.
Can I respond while you're responding?
Not yeah. Under Mayor's comments, but thank you. So I wouldn't want to have to pay the DECD back for not following the outlines of the grant. So it wasn't to really cover the property. DPW. And again, I just want to take this moment to thank the people and all you volunteers who come here a couple times a month and really do the work, and I appreciate it. And we'll move on to item 7, which thankfully Ray is back. And oh, you want to do recycling before Ray? Okay, we're going to do recycling first. Mike, you want to come up and give us an update on the recycling subcommittee, please.
Good evening, Mike. Hopefully you're all given a package that looks like an important looks like that. It's 3 pages, roughly about 3 pages. It summarizes about a year and a half's worth of work from a committee, and I would like to take the opportunity to thank the 6 members who served on that committee, 5 members in addition to myself, 3 of them are in the council, Katie, Beth, Frank, for their time, Jay Lewin as a resident, and Barbara Wolf from Board of Finance. They took a lot of time out of their schedule to understand, I think appreciate, really study what the recycling center does, the services it provides to the taxpayers in Milford. We met with many different vendors, some of our residents that came and spoke at our meetings, several of our employees, both from our representatives, all
do the work at the center, and a host of other people from Hurrah, and like I said, other vendors that supply some of the services that we that we attract and that we work with. So we spent a lot of time detailing, I think, and coming up with the recommendations and findings that we're in this summary report for you. It summarizes it pretty well. You don't see a lot of major changes, I think, at the center, which is a summary of what's here. But we did a lot of enhancements. Some were ongoing as we progressed as a committee and found things that it could be altered or changed directly as an operations issue. And some sitting here as recommendations for future opportunities to continue to enhance the center and make it a more usable, friendly, service-oriented location for our residents. So I think overall, as a committee, we believe that the center runs well. I guess how I'm going to say this, it is holding its own at this point in time. We've done financial studies as part of our progression to this, and we looked at 4 years now of data for that operation. Year one, which I believe was year 2012-13, that we looked at, the center was bleeding some money, not a real lot at the time, and it's progressed to the point over that 4 year span now to, I hate to say make money because it's not really making money, it's sustaining its operation. So we aren't detracting from that waste management fund that would otherwise pay for the offsetting costs if it were not making.
It's not the waste management.
Landfill settlement. Thank you. That would otherwise offset it. Basically, that would be taxpayer money that would be going towards the center rather than the operations, the revenues of the operations paying for the center operations. So, I'll just entertain some questions from you, really, if anybody has something specific about it, without going through all three pages. I think you guys have an opportunity to review it. So,
I've always had an interest in what goes on down at recycling. I think it's an important project in this town, and I am ecstatic to see that two things, the amount increasing the fees, because when we increase the fees, people will have a tendency just not to use it, and then we're back to dumping stuff along the side of our roads. And the second thing is, and I remember this coming up before, not going out to a third-party vendor, I think is a wise choice. This is a department, if you want, or a part of this town that is so important. It is used and utilized by so many people. And if you hand it over to privatization, you lose control of it. I think that the way that it operates, people work down there. If you go down there on a regular basis, particularly on Saturdays, it's
sorry, Joseph.
We're recycling the pencils, but it's a nice environment. It's well run, and there's a lot of people put a lot of effort in there. So keeping it a town asset without outside intervention, I think it's just an incredible feat here. And I'm very glad to see the efforts that went forward here. The only other comment I would make is that it's tragic you cannot take paint down there. But on that note, I have to go out on some note here. And this is the last one.
Thank you. Pete?
Mr. Mayor, thank you, Mike, and subcommittee. A couple questions. First, pertaining to the center usage fees.
Sure.
So it says to maintain consistency and allow for more efficient access to the center. Each residential tier will require a $20 sticker. How much of a sticker is that?
$20.
Same, right?
Correct.
And the same for commercial?
No, 40 for commercial.
40 for commercial.
So the commercial one's the one with the increase.
No, it's the same. No, it's the current increase. If you read into it, it's not the increase.
So no increases. Then the last part is the subcommittee recommendation of an additional non-union part-time center coordinator.
Yes.
Can you kind of expound on that?
Sure. I think what we basically state in here, and I'll read it, the subcommittee members recognize the issues at the center are very fluid with the developments. There's lots of opportunities for managing the materials that we take, and without somebody who does that on a basically a daily basis, it's difficult to reap some of the benefits that recycling offers out there, whether it's new programs, whether it's existing commodities that we take, capitalizing on their markets and as their markets change. And it could be daily, it could be weekly, it could be yearly. But there's opportunities out there that we don't have the time to change without going through these subcommittees and making recommendations, you know, to a council. That's a length of time that it takes to make some of these changes that could otherwise be enhancements to our operation and our services pretty quick. Things like, I know, you know, Joe talks about the paint program. That's a program we waffled around for quite a long time and considered trying to take it. And actually, we might have been better off taking that at the center initially before some of the businesses in town got on board with it. But now that the businesses that sell paint, in our opinion, it's better that the vendors that manage those materials manage those materials in total, because for our operation, it's not the best thing for our operation. There's some other environmental complexities to it that we wouldn't want to have. But initially in the program, it may have been a better opportunity for us, and we may have gotten out of it at this point in time. There's no revenue for us doing that stuff. It's more convenience, and I understand that, you know, there's those things that we weigh out all of those opportunities. But we're limited in space at the center. And so managing all those things is complex. You know, and it's something that needs to be done. You know, we spent quite a bit of time putting those our proper things together and making sure we were understanding exactly what was driving the cost of the center, exactly where we were getting our revenues, and exactly what we were spending our money on all of our expenses throughout the year. And make sure we accommodated all those and understood the fees, the fee structure that was correct enough. That was, you know, six people spending a year and a half doing it. We just feel it's something that we could capitalize on more structured with a coordinator or manager who does that as a function of their job.
Mike, do you envision the coordinator, that person would be able to at least pay for their salary through efficiencies and increased opportunities in recycling?
I absolutely believe so. I think the committee would, and I see some of them shaking their head. I think we all believe that is an absolute offsetting back and forth, yes.
Great. Mm-hmm. Well, Mike, thank you, and thank the subcommittee for doing this, and it's great to see you. No increases, so that's a testament to you guys doing that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to say, sort of back to what you asked, Pete, is that I know you asked the question that I was going to address for you about the payback on it. It took a year and a half and six people to come up with some of the small changes which affected big results. A part-time person, aside from taking the time that Mike and Suzanne take to do this, again, it's not their main job, so things are forgotten or missed, not because they're not paying attention, but this really changes constantly. And scrap of all kinds at any level, I mean, I learned so much about this, every single piece of waste is wanted by someone. To go somewhere, to do something. It's got a value, whether you want to believe it or not, to include organic food waste. So if you're not on top of it, you're missing opportunities. And just one example would be the fact that we are now being paid for the textiles rather than just, you know, letting it go. And we've expanded what can be put in there, and we're paid for it. So, you know, it's just a small example of how someone could help a lot. And the bottom line of keeping it so we're not making a lot of money, but we're not losing money.
Thank you, Beth.
Just again, to support the recommendation for that coordinator, one of the other issues is DEEB is expanding their program that they're going to start enforcing to this within the state itself, and our people won't have enough time to go to DEEB to learn more about these issues because they're working on other things. So this coordinator would be a liaison to the state as well to find out about these upcoming programs a little more timely than the people who are there. and really help us be leaders in recycling.
Frank?
Yeah, I agree with Beth and Katie said, but one of the examples, the air conditioners and refrigerators that we were paying money to have them come in and deactivate them, $15 or $20, what is it? $15. We were able to find a source that not only did it for free, but they took the scrap metal and paid us for it. So we made that into a positive. Beth mentioned the textiles. The tires, we were renting a trailer, several thousand dollars a year to store the tires. And then we paid to have the tires taken out. And we found a vendor where we don't need a trailer because they come once a week or twice a week, depending on how many tires we collect. So we don't have to store them. And we pay for some of them, but if they're serviceable, they don't charge us. So there's another source of income. The point is, we don't know what we don't know. So a person who is full-time and be good looking into the aspects of recycling could probably find a lot of other ways to make that a more efficient operation than it is, because more and more of the things we throw away now can be used in the future with the technology, et cetera. So somebody would be on top of that. But the most important reason that you would have this coordinator, from my standpoint, is education is a big component of recycling. And the more we can educate the public and the children in this community to recycle, and the need to recycle, and the benefits of it, we benefit as a community. And this person would be able to do that via connection between the recycling center and the school. We had said that the cans, we're going to make the cans available to nonprofit organizations. So like the Boy Scouts and the Girl Scouts could collect the cans. Now, there's an education component in that about recycling, and they can make income for their children. These are benefits that we were able to get. And the one benefit, you okayed the quarterly committee, the same recycling committee will meet quarterly. So whatever we recommend, if it needs to be tweaked or changed, then we'll do this on a quarterly basis instead of waiting years to come around to having a recycling committee. And most important, you will get an update on a quarterly basis of whether the center is making money or losing money. Right now, we don't find out about it until the budget period, and we're so overwhelmed with numbers and dollars, we kind of lose track of the recycling. But I think it's important enough to keep the council appraised on it quarterly. So yes, we're ahead of the game, no, we're behind, and why we're behind, so we can make adjustments to make it as efficient as possible.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Mike.
We need to vote on the recommendations, don't we?
Accept
the
final. Well, did everybody get a chance to review these so they want to vote on accepting them?
So, Katie kind of asked, but let me just make sure we're clear. You know, I think one thing we did change, we believe that the council needs to act on it as well. In our guide to operations, previously, residential vehicles, residential stickers were issued per household, and it was $20 per household, and they receive up to 3 stickers. Our recommendation is to change that, and this does say each vehicle. Our guide to operations reflects that change, but that would be a council approval. We believe that
so
the council approval requirement. Our recommendation is for that to begin in 2016.
So instead of the household just paying the $20, it's for each car they get to drive?
For each
so
car.
If my car is broken, I
the recommendation is for each car that they have to drive.
Just so you know, I'm not in favor of that.
I think for this committee, we felt that there's enough administrative time and cost to come into play, that's a change that we felt for efficiency of the center. One of the biggest concerns we have now at the center is track. And that's a big reason, especially as we're renewing stickers, to give out, I hate to say freebies, but people just to get them, because it's easy and convenient, isn't really helping our center operation.
I can only drive one car at a time.
Yes.
Just put someone else to go.
And the two other towns don't charge their people the same way, Brookfield and Sherman.
I just want to make a comment to that. Yes, from a processing standpoint, consistency is efficiency, and that is time.
own car, but you could let someone else use your car. Is that fair for the person who's paying? No. But the bottom line is, we have a quarterly meeting, we have quarterly assessment, and this has come up, not we didn't all agree about that particular item, but it's something that we would like to hear when the next quarter is over, the public can talk about it. You know, I think it's easy for everyone to have an opinion, certainly I do, and you do, and everyone does, but I think we had people on our subcommittee who use it. I don't. I have someone pick my garbage up, so I couldn't really speak to that. However, I want to hear what people have to say. Because remember that every time something isn't efficient, it costs money, and that money is going to have to be made up somewhere. And the bottom line is, well, okay, if we give a free sticker, then maybe we're going to have to raise the per bag price. That affects everybody. So we looked, after a year and a half, as Frank so nicely put it today, there really wasn't much of anything we didn't beat to death. So this is our recommendation. It doesn't go into effect until after the first quarterly meeting would take place. And that's what we're there for. And if somebody came and said to the council, the mayor, gee, I really think this is terrible, well, then it can be changed. But this was our recommendation because it seemed like the most effective way to handle the process and not cause a fee increase elsewhere.
So how does the stickers work then for the other towns that use it? So
they pay us different? A lot of money to get their stickers.
Like Sharon pays, is it 10,000?
15,000.
15, and then they give out stickers for life to all their residents.
So they administer their stickers themselves within mm-hmm. their town. Right. And right now our stickers are administered at recycling, not anywhere else.
Correct. You issue them directly at the recycling center.
So is there any, did anyone look at potentially changing that to like DPW's office? You know, how much time does that take up on a busy Saturday or something when people are trying to get stickers?
Well, it's not the issuing of the stickers. Yeah. It's the processing when you come in with, you have another sticker. Every sticker's got a number, has to be checked. I mean, it's just, well, I don't get to it.
We have our guys put them directly on the vehicle that is being used at the center. So they fill out the application, they bring it right to the center personnel, pay for the sticker there with a check or a punch card or whatever they want to pay with, except cash. But they're issued the sticker and it's placed right on the vehicle at the time that they're in the center.
So these stickers are annually?
Mm-hmm.
So is there like a rush at the beginning of the year where impact services? Or?
We allowed current sticker holders to start applying early, change made a couple years ago. They can start applying in June for the renewal sticker if you already have a current sticker. So that took out some of the traffic.
Yeah, yeah.
We talked about maybe running a group at the senior center where we could have some volunteers go up there and help them get them on their vehicles off center hours. That might take away some of the traffic. Mm-hmm. But,
thanks.
Pete?
Mike, I just want to make sure that reading this properly. So the guide to operations New Milford Recycling Center dated November 20th, 2015 is in our packet.
Yes.
On page 5, C sticker fee. It says until June 30th, 2016, the fee for residential stickers is 20 for the first sticker and there's no charge for stickers for additional vehicles in the same household.
Okay.
So theoretically, if we were to approve this, there still would be time where you could put out something down recycling that, you know what, every car you have is going to be $20.
Right.
So you could get that input from people, and then if it was, you got a big, huge loud outcry.
Say, just like it said here, effective July 1st,
that's
each sticker, each vehicle would require a sticker, and each vehicle would be at $20.
Right.
If you choose to add one more, if you can get away with it, and you want to save money, you have to still have the opportunity to do that if you can bring one car. If you have to have multiple cars, then,
Because what I would like to see is, I would like to see something down there to notify the residents and get their input. As Katie had said, that it's $20 a vehicle, not 20.
There's a tri-fold flyer, aside from what's posted when you pull in. There's also a, and this, the guide, and there's a tri-fold
handout for everyone, and we'll have all of that in there. It'll have the date, and they can certainly. The point of this is not to try to, you know, make it tough on people. The point is that something has to give, as we all know, when costs, you need a certain amount of money to operate. So this is one way to potentially stave off having to raise the per bag fee, which could impact people to a greater degree. So again, it's not until after the first quarter meeting of the subcommittee. It's certainly well into a new administration and plenty of time for people to come forward and tell the council, tell the mayor, tell anybody they want to tell, so it can be addressed.
Frank?
Yeah, the additional cost for the stickers, it's inconvenient for some people, I understand, but we're not talking many, 100?
Yeah, we've got about 100.
So out of the 1,400 or 2,400 stickers, we're only talking about 100 people. But if you have to raise the fee for the bags for the gardens, that affects everybody. So you're inconveniencing 100 people versus inconveniencing the whole town. So we balanced that. We said, look, I think we'd better off having the sticker fee applied, extra stickers.
So are you, who's going to make the motion to add that to the agenda? Suspend the rules?
No, I move to suspend the rules to add
second.
The recycling center.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Thanks, Mike, Director of Finance.
Thank you.
spoken for. You've already borrowed it. You're just paying back. And you've basically spent all of the money. It's for the communication, emergency communication, the roads that we have out there. Some of them set my mind up. Those have to, are just being renewed. Two new items of the scatterfoot route and the turtle. So if you have questions on what's in front of you now, is that was requested, was a 4-year ban for the turf fields or a 10-year ban or bond for the turf fields.
Joe, do you want to ask your question now?
Yeah.
Wait for Ray to...
Let me go with this now. As you know, I've been on that turf committee for quite some time. And one of the goals of the turf committee was to complete this project without going to bonding. And at one point, it was our goal to take it all from waste management at one time, but there's some legitimate reasons not to pull out $4 million at one time for the sake of perhaps helping the community with some tax relief. Going into the next budget season. And then there, the issue of bans have come up, and thank you for this spreadsheet here. I thought it was, you know, one of the things with issuing 4-year bans is that we could then hopefully the new council will take the money for the cost of that ban each year out of waste management at just under $1 million, $900,000 a year in 4 years. It's less of a burden on waste management. It pays it off in a very short period of time, and this cost savings by using... Also, if you pay those bans back, they don't have to be converted to bonds, which saves you on an old big bonding project. And the savings between a 10-year bond and a ban are significant. There's $250,000 in savings. Right there. And the bans are going to cost you over the 4 years, just real quick math, $137,000. I mean, it is the smart, wise way to finance this incredible project. And it would be, to me, just literally ludicrous to put that turf into a 10-year bond. It almost goes against everything that went into the philosophy of putting those getting those fields up and running and going. And at $900,000 a year for 4 years at this minimal interest rate between 0.75 and 2.00, I hope I just hope the council sees the wise move of doing this in bands over that bonding and keeps that incredible project going without it being an exorbitant cost to the town. I mean, it just doesn't make sense to do 10 years on that. So hopefully. The new council and the new mayor follow through with that, and the upside is those bans will be paid off, and they won't have to go into a bond, and the project will be done. The cost will be covered in 4 years quickly, and you can move on to using that waste management money for other great projects in the town, and then in some other things, perhaps that the walk that people are discussing, what the philosophy of that waste management was for. Those parks and those walkways and that open space. And that. So hopefully that will carry through as I say goodbye.
Thank you, Joe. Pete?
Thank you, Mayor. Just quick questions. On the bans themselves, if you were to ban the amount, what's the term for the ban?
This one is 4 years.
Now, is there any prepayment penalty when you pay off a band early?
No, I don't know.
So theoretically, you could ban these on a 4-year band, and every year, right, you're paying the interest, which is from the waste management fund. You could, when you get your uptick, was it every October we get an additional?
Next October, you're going from 1.6 million to 2.7.
Right.
Next up.
So So with that additional increase that we're getting from waste management, you could pay down your van. So basically, theoretically, you could pay that off in 4 years.
Less.
If down.
If the town so chose to do that.
Right. But if we're going for a bond.
Just the difference.
If you're going for a bond, I would have to put a call notice.
Right.
He meant that the difference in the increase of the payment would pay for the fields without impacting what's already in the waste management account.
If you look at the whole account as being stagnant and nothing else is going to
affect it. Right.
So there would be no impact. Just like you said. As long as it was the way that it is now. Right?
Yeah, if you just looked at it in isolation like that.
Right.
And you had 2.7 million coming in next year.
Right.
And you could pay, you know, again, you pay whatever you wanted to pay. You know, you could pay it off early, you could pay it off. Yeah.
With the increase.
With the interest with the increase.
With just the increase. If you're going from 1.6 to 2.7, you leave your 1.1 left over. Just the increase, you know, right. And you won't impact the tax rate.
2.7, which is $270,000 of future revenue stream to the town's budget. again, I don't look at one project and the funding that's going on just for that one project. The state is still wrestling with $350 million. Revenue shortfall. They have to address that. Mm-hmm. We've already been hit by $150,000 that we have in this year's budget that we're not going to get, that we budgeted for. I feel I can cover that. But the resolution that's out there doesn't address the funding, how it's going to be paid for. The funding and how it's paid for is between the finance director and the mayor. That's who determines how a project is going to be paid off once it's approved. So I'm sure the mayor and myself will take consideration of everything that's said. But you have to look at other aspects that are going on in the total realm of things. What's going on that could affect the town and local.
Pete?
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Ray. I just would like it on the record, right? So, because there's a lot of conjecture out in the public, a lot of miscommunication from people that are going around saying that it's an automatic tax increase on turf fields. And we just saw today, right now, that there could be a way that you could do it that would not impact the taxpayer in the municipal budget at all.
Well, it wouldn't with the tenure either. Because, again, the resolution doesn't address the payback. The resolution addresses the borrowing. So on a yearly basis, when the town's putting its budget together, with the mayor, the finance director, the town council, the board of finance, at that time, they vote whether or not to support the debt, whether it be 4 years, whether it be 10 years, whether it be 15 or 20 years.
Right.
That the town general budget is going to be impacted by that debt to take it in from waste management. I feel that the lower payments gives you more to do what may be coming down the pipe. So again, you know, on a yearly basis, you can change your mind. So, we don't want to use waste management anymore for this. We got other plans. So now we're going to, at that point, you would pass it on to the general taxpayer. Okay. So if it's 10 years or 15 years, you don't have to do it every year. You can do it for 5 years and say, no, we don't want to do that anymore.
Other financial report questions? So when you get the update printed, you can email that to everybody. The financial report. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you
for getting back for the meeting. Thanks for getting back for the meeting.
Thank you.
Okay, next is executive session for some tax appeal litigation, inviting in John Power and Kathy Conway, the tax assessor. About a motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We're back from executive session. No motions were made, no votes were taken. Moving to item 9. Discussion of possible action concerning tax appeal litigation pending in Litchfield Superior Court, A, B, and D. Is there a motion?
I move to action on items A, B, and D as discussed in executive session.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? 10. Board of Ed? Is there a motion just for the conversation?
I move to action the request of release of 499927 from the capital reserve account.
Second.
As listed on the agenda.
Who is that?
Me. And Tom.
So we have Mr. Hubblebank here tonight to talk to us about the Board of Ed's request for $499,927.
Good evening. I think you have a letter from the superintendent that addresses those things. There's three items on our list. One is to replace the entire telephone system in the district for a total of about $262,000. This is working with the company that you folks used to do your upgrade recently and purchasing things through the state contract.
We have the letter from Angie Chastain.
Oh, it's Angie. I'm sorry.
Chair, and she did not identify the individual.
Well, I'm sorry. I thought they asked me for the information. I didn't see the letter. I assume they gave that.
All I got was hers as November 13th.
So I'll break it down for you then. $261,900 is for the telephone system. That would be the entire telephone system. Currently, we have three different telephone systems throughout the district that will communicate well. Every time it rains, Sarah Noble's kind of disappear a call there. You get a kind of garbled phone system there. Can't call 911 from the phone directly from the classroom, so that's a concern for us in terms of security. So that the cost there again, had looked at a bunch of different options, including VoIP, cloud-based. We ended up with a digital system primarily because, as you know, when you lose internet and you're in a VoIP system, you lose your telephone. We're concerned that at a school level, we need to have phones when the power goes down, you still have power to the phone system through a generator. You can still run the phone system, and the main part of that will be placed at Sarah Noble, which is where our generator is. So that's part of the system to keep it running. The other concern, and it allows to communicate. Right now, if you call the assistant superintendent and you meant to call my office, he has to give you my number, so he would call my number because you can't transfer them, and you can't transfer from one school to another and those kind of things. So it's a matter of, and the oldest part of the system three of the schools use is, I don't know how old it is, but we are having difficulties being able to get it repaired. We took all the JPS phones and we're using them to repair the old ones in the other places because you can't get parts anymore. So that's really where the phone system is.
So with regard to Sarah Noble as well, just as a reminder, that's also where our main shelter is for when we're sheltering members of the public. We did upgrade, so now they actually have a shower. It would be good to come over. Questions? Katie?
We had a gentleman earlier, Jay, who made a comment. Can you hear them? And will he be given an opportunity to bid this, or was he not given an opportunity?
Well, he was not. We had, this is the history, I've been here a couple of years, but apparently they've been looking into the phone system for a number of years before I came. We have done some bids out there. Put together some specs, and we talked to different vendors about prices. I know it's come before my board a few times before I came along, and we've been looking at it this last year. But the Pettibone move sort of pushed it back a little bit till we got it done. We heard about the work that you folks have done here this past summer, and we had this extensive discussion with the phone company, with Kendrick, who I guess oversaw the implementation. And we talked to the company and asked them. Turns out that they buy the telephones off the state bid, so that helps us with the prices. Mm-hmm. experience you folks had, our board thought it was appropriate to move forward because the pricing still was under the state contract. So we did not go out to bid that way. So we didn't give him the opportunity.
And is that standard procedure for the board, Ed, not to?
Well, I guess there's been a number of cases on this already since I've been here. If there's pricing out there at the state level, at the state contracting level, I think you folks have that same policy. That
so you make the assumption that the state you're making the assumption that the state is getting a better price than anybody else could?
Not necessarily.
Not always. Sometimes they are.
But you can go to them. I've done this too. I've gone to bidders and say, look, if you can beat the state price, I'll go with, you know.
Right.
But in this case, our feeling was, I think strongly, was that given the experience in talking to what happened here with the town and the quality of the work done, and we've had a vendor here who we were trusting that could do the job, so
I'm
we felt that was
not
so, I'm just explaining
that he
that's
brought
how
up the point
yep.
that I thought
yep.
was a valid
yep.
point is that he wanted to know why this company, and of course
yep.
Alcatel is a very well-known company,
and he and I talked about this a week or so ago, so he was aware of it, yeah.
Okay.
That's the process we used.
Okay, so was he told to go and say his piece to the Board of Ed?
No.
Or you're saying that then there's no other place to go?
Well, what happened is, and again, I don't need to speak for him, but he had read it in the paper that it was coming here, so he came here. I don't know whether he plans to come to the board.
Okay, so my question at the bottom line, Jay, is there no opportunity for any other vendor to come forth and be included in the bidding process?
No, not at this point, no.
Okay, so you don't know whether or not he might have been once?
Right, that's correct.
And the reason that you're not going to find out is because?
We already made a decision at the board to go with this company here.
So just to better understand, the state bid is with respect to buying the material.
Right.
So basically the difference in pricing would be the labor aspect of the job.
And then it's a three-year, we have a three-year maintenance warranty with them as well.
So just so I better understand, because my understanding is the Board of Ed doesn't have to follow the same ordinances we do with respect to bidding.
Theirs is stricter. We had that discussion a couple of years
ago.
So you
did solicit bids on this project.
Well, you have in the policy is if you can look at, you can go out to bid,
mm-hmm.
or if, and I'll give you a couple copiers as another example of where rather than go out to bid, you look at what the state contract is, and if you get a vendor that will give you the state contract price or less, our policy is that you can use that state contract instead of having to go out to bid, meeting the specifications that you have. I mean, you're not just taking
any. For a copier, though, that's more of your staff internally in hooking the copier up.
No, I mean, we have a lease agreement. It's a couple $100,000 a year, the copier,
well,
so it's not a cheap number. I mean, you know.
Correct, but with the phone system, there's a different layer where there's programming and
mm-hmm.
other aspects
yeah.
to it that's not typical of something like a heart, good,
right,
like
right,
toilet
true,
paper
right.
or something
yeah,
like
sure,
that.
Sure.
So in this case, we did not go out to bid for the labor.
No.
What was the board's, there was a lot of discussion publicly, and I haven't been able to look back at the minutes with respect to the board's surplus at the end of this year. That was the.
I'm estimating $200,000 at the end of the year.
Okay.
It'll be a little less actually after the audit, but it'll be about a little less than $200,000.
And was there any consideration given for using some of that money?
No, because we didn't have the proposals together at that point in time.
And that $200,000 goes in the same fund we're taking it out of. So.
Right.
So that's why
I
asked
yeah.
why it's
yeah.
not just.
And I just couldn't do it. I mean, if we could have, but I didn't have it. We weren't ready to do that at that point in time.
Okay,
I know this isn't you. I don't need to take time, but you're the guy that's here.
That's
so right. I
yeah,
this
yeah,
question.
So I get this.
I guess if I'm getting this, then that means that if the state's got an amount up here and you or any entity that wants to follow that says, oh, well, we got this is what we can get it for and ask the state, so that's as far as we have to go. In other words, it means you don't do any more work to find a better price.
Well, the state goes out, I mean, just to go back, the state just doesn't put these prices up. They go out to vendors and
yeah.
bid that and get bid prices
right.
for that.
Right. Yeah.
So in this case, we didn't. I would say in other cases, I have used the state price to get vendors to give me a better price. In this case, we didn't because we had a vendor that we felt, we didn't have any other experience with phone companies other than the couple that we're using right now, which we're not all that happy about.
Right, right.
So here we had a company that had experience that was working with the town, that had been working with the town. People said that they did, in talking to folks, they did job, they did a good job.
Tammy actually managed that program for the town.
So that's why we thought the idea was to do that, so that's why. I mean, sometimes you pay a little bit more, but you have somebody that you know you feel like you can work with and trust and go on.
This is the phone system that was just put in a while ago.
Yes.
Shortly.
Well, just a few months ago.
Yeah, so you have a few months of experience with somebody, and so no other bid was... I guess that's my only question, and it's off the table, it can't be changed. But for going forward, I just want to understand something about my tax money that was used. Is that if you can use it to, as you say, get a better price, you do. But pretty much if you don't, you don't have to.
Yes.
That's correct.
But one thing I want to say is I believe the vendor that we're talking about, you've been using them here in the town for a number of years. Not just this.
Oh, okay.
So they have a history.
I'm glad. I feel better about that.
And our history with our vendors.
So because the Board of Ed is a different process than the rest of us. Okay. Thanks.
No, I'm not. I'm going to take it that way.
Thank you,
Frank. Yeah, you said you're using the state bid. I'm thinking there's got to be 20 different phone systems.
Oh yeah.
With features, etc. So how in the state bid is it for a particular system?
Well, it's the phone system, you know, because the handsets are the expensive part of buying all this. It's the hardware part.
Right.
That's the hard part. So we had, I mean, I'm not the tech person who put together the specs, but we had our tech folks who put together the specs of what they were looking for in the phone, and so that's what we looked for.
So the
so they have to meet this spec.
The state specs are basically the same specs that the town has.
Yeah.
Okay. But, and you have no way of knowing who bid for those specs. In other words, somebody got it.
Yeah, I don't know if they list the other vendors on the state. The other vendors that didn't get the bid.
You can get that information. That company might have bid on that.
They might have. And I've told companies in the past, you know, you need to, we're a member of a consortium with 120 other school districts that bid out supplies and other materials. And companies call me up after the fact and they say, well, you need to get on that bid. You know, you need to find out. We direct them to that bid. Same thing with the folks who, you know, want to be on the state bid. You have to put your stuff in there to get on that bid. But the state does the work of vetting those vendors and vetting that information. So to me, they're better at it than I am. So that's all right. You know, I look at it. I don't all the time, but I work it out. Look at it to see. So, right. So the second thing on the list is to move the CEN line to Sarah Noble. CEN is the Connecticut Educational Network. That is the internet system that all of the school districts in the state use. It's a free internet service. They put internet lines up. 1,000 meg line that comes into one building. Apparently, whenever the decision was made, the one building that they put it into was the central office building. I don't know why, but that's where it went. This was years ago. It's been around for at least 10 years now, I guess. We have some issues over there. Our main switching system is at Sarah Noble. It's where our generator is, so it keeps things running. It's where better central location for it. And what happens is, so you know, is that it's all of our internet traffic goes to all the schools on T1 lines to Sarah Noble. It then goes to the central office, and then it goes out I don't make this stuff up.
You couldn't.
So what we're proposing to do is to move the CEN line to Sarah Noble where it should be.
Yeah.
So that it cuts down on, and we have, as you know, we use more and more technology, and the bottlenecks of using the internet have become a problem at times. And the fact is, it's in the basement of the central office building, which gets wet sometimes down there, so it's not a good place to be. It's not air conditioned down there, so that's a problem for us. So it really needs to be in a better place. The cost to do this is done by Frontier. They're the only vendor that does it, so that's what the cost is, and we have to buy some extra equipment to put into Sarah Noble, so that's the price to do this work.
What is that cost?
I'm sorry, I forgot that you didn't have it. It's $113,127.
And does this leave the central office with like cans and strings?
No. We'll still have an internet connection that will go to Sarah Noble and then go out to the internet from there, just like everybody else, but it'll make things much more efficient. The last item is a cost of $125,000. It's to address some issues raised by the Office of Civil Rights Compliance. They did a review of the high school, this is the high school only, about 4 years ago. They gave us an extensive report. I've looked at their reports, hundreds of pages long, it's looking at facilities primarily. We have addressed almost all of their issues. We had not addressed issues in the fields, handicapped access to the fields, as well as some handicapped access in and out of the building. They gave us a letter this past August that came in that said, used to be voluntary, by the way, you only had to do these things voluntarily. Now they gave us a letter that said it's no longer voluntary. You've been putting this stuff off too long, we have to do it now. So it also includes, for example, and I'll give you some examples, the fields, and we've already talked to the turf committee about working with them, providing access to the fields for people in, you know, that are handicapped. Right now with the turf work, all of those fields will be accessible as part of that process, but getting to the baseball field, the softball field, those kind of things won't be. What we've got in here is approximately $25,000 to, we got a proposal from the architect that the turf committee is using to develop the plans to get handicapped access, to develop the specs, to bid the project, and then to oversee the project. We'll go out to bid in this probably January, February, find out how much it costs, and then we may be back for that. But we don't know until we get those bids together. But we felt, and I think we talked with the turf, I went to a turf committee meeting, felt it makes sense to use the same group that's doing that work because we want to have it look the same, you know, as follows, and they understand what's going on.
And they're on site.
And they're on site already. And we think we'd get a better price. Hopefully, I assume the same company is doing the work, we'll bid on it and get a better price to do the work at the same time. The other part of the money in there is for a variety of access doors, door work within the high school. Right now, if you go to the high school and you go to the front door, you buzz in to get into the high school. There's no way to have a handicap paddle or something to push to open the door automatically. There's nothing in the back door. If you try to get out of the auditorium, there's two front, if you're looking, sitting in the auditorium and there's an emergency, there's two doors to the either side. Neither of them are handicapped accessible, and getting in and out of the building at that same place. So we want to put, you know, paddles kind of thing that you can open and close. They will be able to, some of those, we obviously, when we have an event at the auditorium, we open the doors, those things then would be able to be accessed easily. From the front door, we'll still have, when you come to the front door, you'll still have to buzz in and then we can open those doors. But going out of the building, you still can't get out of the building. There's no, the doors don't open up, so there'll be paddles there so people can get in and out. We also need to do that in the gymnasium, and also the elevator is not handicapped accessible, and so we're putting one of the elevators to make that handicapped accessible as well. What's that?
It doesn't have a button to
Yeah, there's no...
The elevators are in there for handicapped people.
Yes,
handicapped
but
accessible?
What we do now, because we don't let the kids anybody use it, you have to, when somebody's injured, you get a key. Well, there's concern by the Office of Civil Rights that it's some people have difficulty turning a key,
right.
So they want some kind of a more
push.
Of a push thing
push.
In there
push.
To open the doors.
Put the key, and then
yeah, and you don't have to do it obviously in all three floors because people use it on
right.
all three.
Right.
And what we'll do is. Somebody who's got an issue, if it's a staff person, we can activate their badge to open. If it's a student, we give them a badge. It just opens the elevator and can use that. So, and the other thing is bathrooms on each floor. They want at least one bathroom, male and female, obviously, on each floor to also be handicapped accessible. Right now, the doors are open. And
yeah,
there's no
right.
other way to,
right.
you know, so that's what that additional funds is for. We do have bids for those things, and that's the cost. And, so those are the three items.
Paul?
So I guess maybe I misasked the question. I'm looking through the operations subcommittee meeting from June and the Board of Ed meeting in June, and it looks like there was a bunch of end of year projects.
Mm-hmm.
The minutes historically used to list those projects, but I see they're not in the minutes anymore. Huh. So one of them that was listed in there was the CEN line.
Yep.
That was going to be under the end of year projects in the operations subcommittee, but then I guess that didn't get approved by the board overall.
At that point, no. That's
so
correct.
What was the dollar amount of those end of year projects, approximately?
Well, we ended up purchasing mostly computer replacements. There's probably about 400,000. I'm off the top of my head. So
okay.
much in that.
And that those were expenses that weren't originally budgeted.
Right.
That was
Absolutely.
Spent
And I think if you remember our budget proposal, we talked about 1,000 computers we had that were purchased in 2007 or earlier. And so we put some of that, we did through our capital funding, but we wanted to, when we had some money left over, there was a real push by the board to want to replace those first as the priority.
So if those expenditures weren't made on those end of year projects, the surplus then would have been 6 or 7
yeah.
thousand?
Sure.
Okay.
the 1% vote.
Other questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item B.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to move to November refunds.
Second.
43 of 567, showing a balance of $18,096.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 13 is Parks and Rec.
I move to accept the gift of a Christmas tree from Mr. and Mrs. Christopher Claus to be placed outside the fire entrance of the town hall.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
How big is the tree?
I don't know how big it is, but it won't have fish in it, like where we stored them that one year in the lake. When we hauled it out, it was filled with fish hopping off the tree and everything. Because it had been cut earlier in the year, we figured we'd stick it in the water and it would be good.
Oh, no way.
But all the fish took and lived in it. So then we had it on the back of a trailer and the fish are hopping out of the tree and everything. And so finally all the fish are out and they truck it down here to set it up. And it stunk like fish, like you would not believe, so they had to replace it.
Motion to adjourn.
Wait, before you do that, I wanted to give Beth and Joe an opportunity to...
Oh.
Because I already said thank you to everybody and how much I enjoyed working here. And I appreciated all your work. And two other people at the table won't be here either, right. So I wanted to offer them the opportunity to make any comment.
Oh, thank you. I already said that.
Oh.
Okay, it's been an absolute pleasure. I'm still going to see. I'll be around. But yeah, no, it's been an absolute pleasure and an honor to serve. And I wish you all the best going forward. Good luck.
I've served in some capacity in this town for 10 years. It's been a pleasure and an honor. And I wish you the best to everybody else. One last thing. Do you recycle name?
This one is now closed.
Trust me, you'll be avoided somewhere at some time in your meeting. And I know how cautious you are about spending money, so make sure you
motion to adjourn.
Second.